أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الخلق والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، فعلمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما، وأرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، واجعلنا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه، وأدخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. آمين. The lecture for today is really one of the most dangerous one. And I would like you to really open your mind and focus. Because what we are talking about is how to reach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how to purify ourselves in order to enter Jannah without punishment, without problems or struggles in the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, when somebody wants to be a doctor, a medicine doctor, so he go to university to learn. He cannot be a doctor without learning. And we cannot reach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without learning. Because the Islam is the religion of knowledge. And the first word revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Iqra, read. And read here, the scholar said, it is to get more knowledge, to understand, to learn. So you cannot do any skill or any job in your life without learning. So we have to learn. We cannot perform our prayers correctly if we didn't learn. We all know, for example, that the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when you perform sujood, you have to perform it on 7 members of your body. And when I look to the people when they are praying, unfortunately, they forget the 7th one. They perform the sujood on 6 members. They forget the 7. So do you think that these people know or they don't know? They don't know. If they know that this will affect their prayer, it might be not accepted. It might be rejected. Unfortunately, when they will know that, it will be too late. That's why I'm saying that we need to learn. We need to learn. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in order to bring you to the main subject for today, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the boycott in Mecca, that is called Sha'b Bani Hashim, the valley of Bani Hashim, he spent there 3 years. Right? 3 years. Yes. And Khadija radiallahu anha, because she was a noble person in Mecca, so the kuffar, they gave her the option. She was the only person who was given the option either to stay with her husband sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the valley under the boycott, or she can stay at her home in Mecca and very protected and respected. What did she choose? She chooses to stay with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she knows that will be a difficult. There will be a lot of challenges, and nobody knows for how long. 3 years. They spent a very harsh time. They didn't find a food until they eat the roots of the trees and the leaves. Can you imagine this situation? And then after the 3 years is over and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his will, the boycott contract is tiered. So after that, and the Prophet sallallahu, he was in really desperate because his own people, they are fighting him. They are not listening to him. The people whom they used to believe and trust in him, now they are resisting him. At this moment, and at this time, Khadija passed away, radiallahu anha. It was a terrified time and a very critical time for the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His beloved wife, his only supporter, she passed away, radiallahu anha. And who write the death on her? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who loves Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. No one will run away from death. No one. And if Allah will allow anyone to have immortal life, He could allow it for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is truly happened. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the choice. As in the Sahih Bukhari, the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna abdan," that a servant of Allah, Allah has given him the option either to live immortal in this life or to join Allah in the day after. So the companion who was listening to him, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, what did he choose?" He said, "He chose Allah. He chose Allah." So yes, indeed, at this critical time, the Prophet ﷺ, he lost his wife. And then he lost his uncle Abu Talib. Two big supporters for the Prophet ﷺ, who was helping him in resisting Quraysh, in staying and maintaining his psychological situation and physical situation in front of Mecca people. So he lost both of them. So this is a big message to every Muslim that no one will stay with you at all forever. No one. You gonna leave. We all gonna leave and depart this dunya. And we gonna go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is going with you? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the dead ones is followed by three things: his family and his money and his deeds. Two will go back and one will stay with him. His money and his family will go back and his deeds will stay with him. So what deeds you want to have with you to be your Jalees, who's sitting with you all the time. Now, as I mentioned, the hadith of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim, that the purification process, right, four happenings, four processes happening in the dunya. The first one is the tawbah, repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second one is al-istighfar. You ask Allah forgiveness. The third one is doing good deeds to wash away the bad deeds. And the fourth one is the tests and the trials. Now, if all these four processes was not sufficient and enough to wash away all your sins, either because maybe the tawbah, the repentance, was not correct and perfect. If the tawbah was not perfect, it won't wash away the sins. Tawbatun nasuh. Istighfar was not enough, was not sufficient, was not from the heart. The good deeds was too low. The prayer was not enough, was not perfect. And the test and trials, unfortunately, didn't work. So maybe he was safe. So what's gonna happen with this fellow? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, indeed, he is Ghafoor al-Rahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Wallahu yuridu, what Allah wants. Wallahu yuridu an yatuba alaykum. Allah wants to forgive you. That's what Allah wants to do with us. In order to forgive us, He gives us process after process after process in order to wash away all our sins. So, the first thing happening after that, at the time when our soul goes out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ويضل الله الظالمين ويفعل الله ما يشاء. What this verse means? The scholars of the tafsir said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give those whom he wants the ability to say the right thing in the dunya and in the day after. So what is the right thing in the dunya? They said, when you die, to say La ilaha illallah. And in the day after, when you are in your grave and the two angels come to ask you, Allah will give you the ability to answer correctly. And this gift only for those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يثبت الله الذين آمن بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. So now the question, what is the benefit for us to say La ilaha illallah at the last moment in our life? What is the benefit? The benefit is, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من كان آخر كلامه من الدنيا, whom his last word was in this dunya, La ilaha illallah, he will enter Jannah. But this is not easy. This is not for everyone. This is a gift. Gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I remember a story of one scholar. He was a scholar in the hadith. He was dying. So his peers, they come to remind him to say La ilaha illallah. Now, they don't want to say it directly because they don't want to hurt his feelings, because he's their imam. So one of them start narrating the hadith, narrated by this companion, another from this companion. He mistake in the series of the narration. Then the other fellow, he said, no, you are, this is wrong. Then the other fellow tried to correct the series of the narrators. Also, he make mistake. Then the scholar who was dying, he said the series of the narrators correctly until he said, "Man kana akhiru kalamihi la ilaha illallah," and he passed away. This is a gift from Allah. It is a gift. So, how can we get this gift? That's why I'm telling you, this is a very dangerous lecture. How can I this gift when I die to say La ilaha illallah? Many people, even though you remind them, say La ilaha illallah, he won't say it. He won't. Their heart is busy with something else. This is it. When you get something shock, something shocking, maybe you fell down or something comes to you. So what is your first response? When you sleep and you see a nightmare, so what kind of speech, of words you are saying? This is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam ibn al-Qayyim said, indeed, to say La ilaha illallah when you die, it has a big effect in washing all your sins, because it's a witness from a weak person who lost the connection with the dunya, with life. And his heart now is connected with the day after, whom he believes at this moment that he lost all connections except one connection with Allah. And his all desires is gone, is fast, past. No more connection with desires and life things, but now he is aiming and going towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why it will be pure and serious from his heart. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look to this hadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, a man will be brought to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the judgment day, and he got a 99 records of bad deeds. You know, we have two angels, Raqib and Atid. ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد. So those two angels, their mission is to write what you say and what you do. Everything. So they have two books. Bad, the good one, and the right one. Now, that fellow, he got 99 records of bad deeds. And the Prophet ﷺ said, every record is very long as you can see in your eyes. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him, have my servants, the angels, were fair with you? He said, yes. Then Allah will ask him, did you deny anything from what is written in these records? He said, no. I confess. Everything written, I did. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, today is the justice day. You will be treated fairly. But still, you have one record in your good deed. Then that fellow will say, oh Allah, what one record will do against 99 records with this big hell? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, today is the justice day. Put it in the scale. So when they put the 99 records in one scale and that one record on the right scale, then the Prophet ﷺ said, then all the 99 records float up. Then he look, that person, he don't know even what is there. Then he looked to that record. He found written on it, La ilaha illallah. Then the Prophet ﷺ comment, nothing will weigh anything against La ilaha illallah. With La ilaha illallah, nothing. To understand how serious is La ilaha illallah, the Prophet ﷺ said that the belief, our faith, is a few and 70 degrees. Or in another hadith, 73 degrees. The highest level of our faith is La ilaha illallah. And the lowest one is to remove the debris from the ground or from the way. So La ilaha illallah is something on the top of our belief. Then a question here should come to our mind. Every Muslim say La ilaha illallah. But how come that some Muslimin will enter hellfire? If he has that record which is written on it, La ilaha illallah, how come he will enter hellfire? Right? This is a good question. So the scholar said, La ilaha illallah also has degrees. It depends how it works in your life. How? So when you implement La ilaha illallah in your life correctly and perfectly, then it will be very heavy in the scale of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people, they just say La ilaha illallah and they don't know what does it mean. They don't know, unfortunately. And that's why I started this lecture by encouraging you to learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Fa'lam أنه لا إله إلا الله. He is teaching the Prophet to understand and reflect upon this word, لا إله إلا الله. So to say لا إله إلا الله is not a speech, is not a words. It's a belief in your heart and it's an action with your body. Now, we should know one thing very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, indeed, He is forgiving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He write the mercy upon Himself. He is Ghafurun Rahim. Right? He is Ghafurun Rahim. And in the Hadith al-Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O my servant, if you come to me with bad deeds in the volume of the whole world, I will come to you with the forgiveness equal to your good deeds. But we have to know a very important thing. The forgiveness is connected with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we don't know, there is no guarantee that we can get that or we can't. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنِّي لَغَفَّارٌ لِمَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا. So Allah Ghaffar, He forgive the big sins and He forgive the huge sins and the many and total number of sins. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But indeed, how we will survive with La ilaha illallah. And this is the most important thing for today. So, La ilaha illallah, it is the main reason for this creation in the whole universe. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. The whole creation of this universe was for La ilaha illallah. That is the main reason. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created us for it. And He sent the messengers for us because of La ilaha illallah. All the messengers of Allah, their message was to say La ilaha illallah. All the messengers. So that's why it's very important. So La ilaha illallah, it means that no one worthy to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, to make you understand how we can get to this point, imagine somebody who is on diet program. Can he eat everything? Yes or no? No. He has a schedule of food, all type of foods which he can eat and he cannot eat. So he is on diet. So when he offered any kind of food or meal, he stopped and think, is this food good for me? Is it according to my diet? It will hurt me? It will help me? It is good or bad? So this is how we should deal in our life with La ilaha illallah. How? Everything happening to us in our life, we should think, is it according to La ilaha illallah or not? Is it going with or going against? That's it. Who is always, his heart is thinking about Allah all the time. His heart is connected with Allah all the time. When he go to bed, when he go to work, when he go to school, when he come back home, his heart always connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, always trying his best to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this gift happening to him. It's a blessing from Allah. And that's why one of the dua which the Prophet ﷺ teach us, Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-qawla al-thabiti fil hayati al-dunya wa fil akhirah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the ability to say the right thing when we die and the right answer when we are questioned in the grave. Now the scholars said there is 8 conditions, and I will not take too long. I will just mention it quickly. Conditions for La ilaha illallah to be true. The first one, to understand the full meaning of La ilaha illallah, which means that no one deserves to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everyone else is false. Everyone else is false. The second one, the true belief that no one deserves to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A true belief. And the third one, to be sincere that La ilaha illallah is only for the sake of Allah, not for any benefit for you in dunya or with someone else. Ikhlas, purification, pure for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say it from your heart and you believe in it. Keep in mind that the belief in heart should reflect on your actions. If your actions violates your belief, then your belief is fail. It's not a belief. And the fourth one, to be truthful, which means, as I mentioned, your words should be reflected in your actions. That means, when I do anything, it should be according to what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then number five, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should love Him. We must love Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. So there is a condition. If anyone say La ilaha illallah but he don't love Allah, then he's a fail. That's fail for him. And the scholars consider him as kafir if he don't love Allah. That's how serious it is. And how come we are not loving Him subhanahu wa ta'ala? He bless us with everything we have. Everything we enjoy it in this life, it all comes from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. How come we don't love Him? And the sixth one, to follow the rules of Allah and obey Him, full obedience. Full obedience to Allah's instruction and Sharia. Don't hesitate. Don't argue. As I mentioned last lecture, when the order comes for the companion to forbid al-khamr, they destroy it immediately. When the order comes to the woman to put the hijab, and they don't have the hijab at that time, they start cutting their clothes and they put it as a hijab. There is no argue about it. No question. We will not say, oh, this is style, or this is culture. No, we are not following styles. We are not following culture. We follow the deen. That's it. Our guideline is our deen. It's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then number seven, to accept and be satisfied with the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is happening is happening. I have to be satisfied with it because it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All destiny is written by Allah. Everything is written by Allah. We should be pleased because it comes from the one who loves us. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the eighth one, to reject everything else other than Allah from the worshipping. And we believe that it is fake. So, for example, we don't follow what the others saying. We don't follow the bid'ah. We follow the sunnah. We believe that the Christian and the Jew, they are following a fake belief. This is the sunnah. This is the belief of the people of the sunnah and jama'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ means, الطاغوت means everyone false god, the false god, false gods. And we believe that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who know the future, al-ghayb. He is the one who give benefit for us for anything. Nothing could benefit us. Not the stones, not anything written, not books, nothing. You know, many people, they have this hijab, they have others. Nothing could benefit us except by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wants you to enjoy something, He will give it to you. If Allah forbid it from you, it will never reach to you. And the dua has to be always to Allah. We are not asking dua for anyone, for anyone else, means anyone dead. But still you can ask your brother to make dua for you. But you cannot ask a dead person to make dua. Even when you go to the Prophet and you visit his grave, we are not allowed to ask the Prophet to make dua for us. That is haram. So when we follow the rules of Allah and we follow the halal, we forbid the haram, we are satisfied and feel pleased with everything happening, everything comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us this gift. And at the end, the dua. Brothers, dua is very powerful tool. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every prayer to give you the ability to say La ilaha illallah when you die. When you die, when the soul start going out from your body, the tongue will cease. The tongue will cease. Cannot speak a word except by the will of Allah. So this is it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ghafoor al-Rahim. Indeed, yes. But still, we have to do our part. And as I mentioned to you, be like the one who is on diet. Everything you do, you check it with La ilaha illallah. Is it according to La ilaha illallah or not? When you do anything, when you say anything, keep in mind, the records will come and will be presented in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, what do you like to have in your records to show it to Allah? This is it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us the ability to say La ilaha illallah when we die. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the gift when we meet Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and we transfer to His word. والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم اجمعنا على ما يرضيك واجعلنا من المتحابين فيك اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مباركا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده معصوما ولا تجعل منا ولا فينا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم إنا نسألك القول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة اللهم اجعل أحسن أعمالنا خواتيمها وأفضل أيامنا يوم نلقاك اللهم اجعل آخر كلامنا من الدنيا لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله عليها نحيا وعليها نموت اللهم توفنا مسلمين وألحقنا بالصالحين وأدخلنا جناتك جنات النعيم مع الأنبياء والمرسلين والصديقين إنك غفور رحيم ربنا توفنا وأنت راض عنا اللهم لا تقبضنا إليك إلا وأنت راض عنا اللهم ارض عنا وعن آبائنا وأمهاتنا وعن أزواجنا وأولادنا وذرياتنا واجعلنا في عبادك الصالحين. ربنا آمنا بما أنزلت واتبعنا الرسول فاكتبنا مع الشاهدين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وآله وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.